We're at video 35, the 11th on blending inheritance, and our second on Fleming-Jenkin. What's that? Yes, it does look rather strange, doesn't it? You'd think it would be pronounced Fleeming, but in fact it is Fleming-Jenkin. Now in video 34, we noted how Jenkin and Darwin both distinguished small and large-scale variations, but were vague as to their relative roles in evolution. Here we'll be considering Jenkin's views on blending inheritance and the limits of variation. We begin with blending inheritance. Jenkin pointed out that while the frequent small-scale variations, often associated with some quantitative trait like height, might persist despite blending effects, the rare large scale variants stood little chance of succeeding in displacing by natural selection other members of the population. By virtue of their low numbers, they would likely be swamped by the majority population. He gave as an example of what he called swamping by numbers a group of black organisms among whom appeared a white variant that happened to be favored by natural selection by virtue of what he called some advantage of structure. So he considered a case where white was superior to black. Jenkin said he used the white character simply to bring to the senses the way in which qualities belonging to one individual in a large number may be gradually obliterated. So we have a number of blacks among which appears a single white. Initially the single white could only cross with one of the black majority. So we have a single white, the lucky member of the black majority, and an offspring which, if blended, would be grey. I've only drawn one here. This would be favoured more by natural selection than the black, but less by natural selection than the parental white. And again, being in a minority, it would find only another black with which to cross. So the offspring again would be blended, this time a slightly darker shade of grey. With further blending, the children would become less and less grey and more black. This blending pattern of inheritance would continue until the tendency towards whiteness and its associated advantages would be completely lost. In Jenkin's words, the advantage of structure, possessed by one isolated specimen is enormously outbalanced by the advantage of numbers possessed by others. So that hardly any conceivable advantage would enable the descendants of a single pair, that is of whites, to exterminate the descendants of many thousands, that is blacks, if they and their descendants, the greys, are supposed to breed freely with the inferior variety, the blacks. Today we would moderate this by pointing out that it depends on the degree of what Jenkins called the advantage of structure. For example, if we designate a regular rabbit as black, and a rare variant as white, then the rare variant might well disappear, so supporting the blending argument. Loss of the rare variant could be due to blending or due to a chance event like being struck by lightning, a process sometimes referred to as drift. But loss of the main population would not be due to a chance event. It would be due to natural selection. Here, the rare variation might have conferred resistance to a rabbit plague like myxomatosis. So, in an epidemic, natural selection could determine that white was the solitary survivor. Jenkin in 1867 would have declared this to be a rare sport and would suggest that we may suppose the offspring of the sport to reproduce the advantageous peculiarity undiminished. In this case, the new variety will supplant the old species. But this theory implies a succession of phenomena so different from those of ordinary variations which we see daily that it might be termed a theory of successive creations. It does not express the Darwinian theory and is no more dependent on the theory of natural selection, note, not natural selection, but the theory of natural selection, than the universally admitted fact that a new strong race, not intermarrying with an old weak race, that is reproductively isolated, so not blending, will surely supplant it. So much may be conceded. Whatever he was doing, it doesn't seem that Jenkin was here conceding anything. Samuel Butler may have been thinking of Jenkin when he made the famous remark in 1878, "The origin of variation, whatever that is the only true origin of species." And in 1887, Francis Galton gave his perception of the differences between the outcomes of non-blending and blending inheritance in an address to the Anthropological Institute. When heritages are mutually exclusive, that is, non-blending, a rare variety may have numerous chances of establishing itself, one in each of many successive generations. Until it is wholly abolished, it will present itself again and again for competitive examination by natural selection, without diminution of vigour. And if it has natural advantages over the general population, it has a corresponding number of chances of profiting by them. That is, natural selection will favour it. With some hand-waving, he went on, "The conditions are far different with heritages that blend." Heritages that blend. In these cases, the peculiarity, white, of one parent is diluted by the black majority to half its amount in the very first generation, so that under the most favourable supposition of the offspring of that parent mating together, that is, grey with grey, and never mixing their blood with outsiders and not suffering from this close interbreeding, they would only be mulatto. No more than one half of the original peculiarity, the original character, could possibly become an established characteristic. It is between these two extremes that the facts of inheritance really lie. Apart from the scale of variation and blending inheritance, Jenkin also focused Darwin's attention on the limits of variation. Darwin was more taken aback by Jenkin's above blending argument than by his arguments on the limits of variation, although these arguments were probably the most important. Jenkin had in mind the end result of variation, an entire variant organism. He didn't distinguish the process of variation that obeyed what he called the laws of variation, about which nothing was then known, and the actual variant itself, the end result that obeyed what he called the laws of matter, about which they were equally ignorant at that time. Thus he referred to the rate of variation in a given direction as more important and as likely to be constrained by some physical difficulty, that is, the laws of matter. So some physical difficulty would constrain the rate of variation in a given direction. As an example of this, he turned to the breeding of race horses that had been going on for many centuries. Beginning with average stock, a breeder would, by selection, in a few generations, obtain horses able to run much faster. These small-scale speed variations would be progressively accumulated, but the rate of improvement would soon decline and approach a limit. In Jenkin's words, hundreds of skillful men are yearly breeding thousands of races. Wealth and honor await the man who can breed one horse to run faster than his fellows. But this would be to no avail. The existence of a limit, as proved by the gradual cessation of improvement, is the point we aim at establishing. Possibly, in every case, the limit depends on some physical difficulty, sometimes apparent, more often concealed. He drew a picture of this in terms of what he called a sphere of variation. So here is Jenkin's sphere. The sphere consists of a species of organism. Most of the individuals in that species have the average properties of the species, the average characters of the species, and they are clustered at the center, and they are able to vary in any direction. But there are extreme forms, outliers, and some of the outliers are still able to vary in every direction, but as one approaches the limit, a stage is reached where further improvement, that is, if it is a positive character, is no longer possible. In Jenkin's words, a given animal or plant appears to be contained within a sphere of variation. A sphere of variation. One individual lies near one portion of the surface, another individual of the same species near another part of the surface, the average animal at the center. Any individual may produce descendants varying in any direction, but is more likely to produce descendants varying towards the center of the sphere, and the variations in that direction will be greater in amount than the variations towards the surface. Thus, a set of races of equal merit indiscriminately breeding will produce more colts and foals of inferior than of superior speed, and the falling off of the degenerate will be greater than the improvement of the select. And again, although many domestic animals and plants are highly variable, there appears to be a limit to their variation in any one direction. This limit is shown by the fact that new points are at first rapidly gained, but afterwards more slowly, while finally no further perceptible change can be effected. Great, therefore, as the variability is, we are not free to assume that successive variations of the same kind can be accumulated. There is no experimental reason for believing that the limit would be removed to a greater distance or passed simply because it was approached by very slow degrees, that is, many small-scale variations, instead of by more rapid steps, that is, a few large-scale variations, or, as Jenkin would have said, sports. So if an individual near the surface of Jenkin's sphere happened to cross with another individual located closer to the center, the children would tend to be drawn closer towards the center. Whatever character we would be examining, that character would approximate more closely to the character of those at the center rather than those at the surface of the sphere. However, implicit in Jenkin's analysis is the idea that two individuals near the surface of the sphere might reproduce. In this case, their children would retain their position near the surface of the sphere, but there would never be an ability to escape beyond the limits of the sphere, the species. And we'll continue with Jenkin's criticisms of Darwin in the next video, video 36.